In one of my last technical interviews, I was asked about the frequent questions I hear from developers about Angular and the problem they have faced with it. The goal of my interviewer was, in fact, to gather feedback about the framework and check how it could be optimized to meet the audience's requirements and offer a good developer experience. After thinking about it and refining my answer, I wanted to share it with you in this post and break down the most common bad practices I've seen Angular starters, including my previous self, do. The reason for these mistakes was often not being aware of them because of a lack of training or mentorship about how the framework works. So I'm making this video to help you build stronger Angular apps and save you a lot of hassles such as experiencing a performance degradation. The first bad practice I've witnessed was forget to unsubscribe. When you subscribe to an observable, a subscription object will be produced which could cause memory leaks at runtime if it's not handled properly. To delete this subscription object when your components get destroyed by Angular, you need to unsubscribe. You can do it as follows. You need to add a subject variable to your component. It's unsubscribe in this case. You need to call takeUntil from the rex.js operator library inside the pipe method, and then you need to call the unsubscribe next and unsubscribe complete inside the ng-destroy method of your component. The second bad practice I have witnessed was not using the onPush change detection. To keep the HTML template and the internal model state synchronized, Angular came up with two change detection strategies. They are the default and onPush strategies. Unlike the default or check always strategy, the onPush or check once strategy doesn't detect change automatically, but only when it's necessary. This reduces the change detection cycles and the computation it takes dramatically. And as a result, it improves the performance. So if we take this example, we can see here a lot of inputs, which means the values for these fields will come from the hosting component. But what we have to detect, or what is critical for this component, is in fact the changes that will happen for option list array and the changes that will happen for option search config parameter. In my first trial with Angular, I didn't have enough knowledge about the onPush approach and what I should do in order to use it properly. Only after witnessing poor performance and starting looking for a remedy, I became more aware of it. So onPush change detection is useful, but you have to keep in mind that it could not be used out of the box. The third bad practice I have seen was not considering the immutability in the code design. A mutable object is an object whose state can be modified after it is created. Mutables are the objects whose state cannot be changed once the object is created. Using Angular onPush change detection strategy when it makes sense is crucial, but what's more important is making your application ready for it by considering the immutability while designing your code and the interaction between your components. Otherwise, some bugs and regressions in your application will start creeping in when you switch to onPush without being prepared for it. So if we take this component, which is a custom autocomplete, it has a list of inputs that will get the values from the hosting component. The value of options list will be changed at runtime. That's why we have this logic to execute whenever there is a change here. Let's have a look at how this component is used. It's used in this hosting or parent component in query in dialog. As we can see, there is a subscription here to the data list observable. And whenever a new value will be emitted from this observable, it will be received by options lists with a new reference, thanks to the usage of async pipe. which means the changes in this option list value will be detected and will be rendered correctly to the user. So we have respected the mutability concept in our option search overlay, and we will not have some trouble while using OnPush. I've put a link in the description below to a post Angular Performance 5 OnPush Change Detection Case Studies. In that article, there are 5 real-world examples of analyzing different components and adjusting their data structure by considering immutability in order to migrate to OnPush smoothly without risk of making the app prone to errors. The bad practice number 4 was not using data binding correctly. Data binding allows us to define the communication between the DOM and the component. It takes care of the automatic pull and push of data between the component and the template. In Angular, there are 4 data binding types: event binding using parentheses, property binding like this one and this one, and string interpolation or mustache syntax using double curly braces. And there is also a 4th type, which is two-way data binding using this syntax to ensure that the data model will be automatically synchronized in the view. At the beginning of their journey with Angular, some developers might not understand the binding syntax correctly and use parentheses instead of curly braces, or using the two data binding syntax where it's not in fact required. You should be careful with two data binding syntax because it could lead to poor web performance as time goes on. Bad practice number 5 was calling methods in string interpolation. The string interpolation is a special syntax that allows us to write some JavaScript expression inside double curly braces to add dynamic content to the web page. If the data has to be transformed before being displayed on the view, you need to be careful and avoid doing it by calling a method inside the curly braces, like in this case, because this would hurt your app performance and the user experience. A better way to convert your data in such cases is by using AngularPipe. Instead of defining the getTotal method in your component and calling it inside the HTML page with data and call.key as arguments, you can define a custom pipe, as I will show now. So you can define the getTotal pipe, which should implement pipe transform from Angular framework. It has here the transform method, which takes the two arguments and call getTotal in order to calculate the total or the sum of all the data in this data source for this column name. After defining your pipe, you can use it as follows. So this is the name of the column, and this is another argument, data source data. But practice number 6 is mixing components and services responsibilities. The Angular framework offers developers the possibility to define components and services that take care of different logic. Yet some developers mix this logic by injecting an HTTP client, for example, inside a component instead of doing it in a service, and just use that service in the component. Although this is a simple scenario of mixing responsibilities and violating clean code rules, there are much more cases that aren't as obvious as this one, such as implementing a feature in just one component, where we could create two or more components that have different roles by applying the container presenter pattern. A container component takes care of getting the data from the services and communicating this data using inputs and outputs to its children components or presentational components. A presentational component takes care of rendering the UI and handling the interaction with users. It could also have a service injected in it to reduce the number of inputs and outputs in the components tree that pass data between the container and children. As you can see here, this is a long list of input output communicated between the container and the present, or the parent and the child components. The same concept of having separate components applies as well to services. In an Angular app, you can define, for example, an HTTP service, as you can see here. So this is extending base HTTP service, which should communicate the REST API. It has the HTTP client from Angular common HTTP injected in it. And we can also have an observable data service, which is a behavior subject-based service that can play the role of a store in your application. It allows you to reduce the code complexity by avoiding the integration of a third-party library like NGRX or NGXS to manage the app state. Here we have some variables and some observable that are in fact holding the data that we have got from the backend. Another kind of service that we can have in an Angular app is a form service, which is very useful in case you need dynamic forms in your application. I have an example here. Form group service. It can take care of the creation of all the form fields, as we can see here. We have an array of form control definition, and for each element in this array I am adding control to my form group. A form service can also take care of adding the logic or the validation logic to your form, filling your form with the right values, and adding the right event listeners to your fields, and so on. But practice number 7 is wrong usage of lifecycle hooks. Methods like ng on init, ng on changes, ng after view init, and ng on destroy are in fact known as lifecycle hooks in Angular because they are called by the framework automatically at some specific events, like when a component is initialized, or when the view is displayed on the screen, or the view is being removed from the screen, and so on. This means that you don't need to call these methods manually in your code as you do for a method you have defined by yourself. Another point you need to remember about lifecycle hooks is that in order to use them, your component has to implement their appropriate interfaces. So in this case, my component, dynamic stepper component, has to implement those interfaces. Otherwise, they would be normal methods and will not work as it is expected. Ng on init come from this interface, ng on changes come from this one, the last lifecycle hook here comes from this interface, and ng after view init comes from after view init, which belongs in fact to Angular core package. The last bad practice for today is not building for production. Although we use build for production to generate a bundle that is ready to be deployed on the server, running ng build --prod on our local machines allows us to see some errors in our application that we cannot see when we build just with ng build. Nevertheless, some of my colleagues and I forget to build our apps with --prod parameter to check them regularly. Only when we face an unpleasant surprise after a new deployment on the server and we try to reproduce it locally, we remember what we have forgotten. Another issue I've witnessed with the ng --prod parameter was not using it at all and deploying a bundle for the server that is not built for production. It was generated just with ng build. This has of course prevented the application from some performance benefits. If you'd like to read, I've put a link in the description of the video to an article regarding these common Angular mistakes. If you enjoyed this content and feel it was valuable, subscribe to my channel, like this video and share it with your friends. Thanks for watching and see you next time!